This is the third lecture on waves. In the first lecture on waves, we made a distinction between the oscillation and the wave. The oscillation of a particle is about its mean position, whereas the mean position is fixed, whereas wave is a disturbance which travels in the medium. We also learnt that there are waves which require a material medium to transmit or to propagate. These waves are called mechanical waves. On the other hand, there are waves like electromagnetic waves which do not require any medium for propagation. Then we learnt that there were two types of waves: longitudinal waves, in which the particles oscillate in the same direction as the propagation of the wave, and transverse waves, in which the particles oscillate in the direction perpendicular to the direction of wave propagation. In the second lecture, we did some exercises, some examples, and we also learnt the important concept of superposition of waves. If there are two waves which are travelling on the same string, let us say, in the same direction or in opposite directions, then they interfere, and the result is that the displacement at each point can be added, and sometimes the amplitude becomes large when we call constructive interference, and sometimes the amplitude becomes very small, what we call destructive interference. Let us see mathematically what happens. We have two waves, and the displacement of one is y 1 equal to a sin 2 pi n 1 t, and the displacement of the other is equal to a sin 2 pi n 2 t. N 1 and n 2, they differ by very small amount. They are nearly equal. Say they might differ by 2 hertz or 3 hertz or 4 hertz at the most. So, n 1 and n 2 are nearly equal. And to find the resultant, we have to find the sum. So, y is equal to a sin 2 pi n 1 t plus a sin 2 pi n 2 t. The amplitudes are equal. The frequencies, however, are slightly different. And if you use trigonometry, you can get 2a cosine 2 pi and 1 minus n 2 by 2 times t, and sin 2 pi and 1 plus n 2 by t. This n 1 plus n 2 by t is almost equal to either n 1 or n 2, because both are almost equal. So, this then becomes the vibration of these two waves, I mean one of these waves, or because both have the same frequency almost. So, therefore, this is the vibration. This part becomes the amplitude of this wave which is moving with frequency n. This becomes the amplitude part, 2a cosine 2 pi n 1 minus n 2 by 2 times t. Since n 1 is almost equal to n 2, we cannot make them equal. This will become 0 otherwise. So, let us see what happens. So, we have a wave of almost the same frequency, but now the amplitude of the wave is a cosine function, and the argument of the cosine is 2 pi n 1 minus n 2 by 2 into t. Now, the argument of cosine function, you know, the cosine function will become plus 1 in one cycle and minus 1 in the same cycle. That is twice, once it becomes maximum, once it becomes minimum. So, twice in a cycle we will have amplitude maximum if you in this direction as well as in that direction. Now, the loudness of sound or intensity of sound depends upon the square of the amplitude. Therefore, in one cycle, loudness is twice in one cycle, because the amplitude, large amplitude in this sense also gives loudness, and the large amplitude in this direction also gives the same loudness. So, in one cycle there is twice the loudness, what is called the waxing of sound. And if you, the same argument will tell you that in one cycle twice there would be waning of sound. That means what? That means the frequency of the beats would be equal to twice n 1 minus n 2 by 2, that is equal to n 1 minus n 2. So, if we have two waves of almost equal frequency, then the number of beats, that the number of times the sound becomes loud, is n1 minus n2. Why? Because the cosine function gives us amplitude one time plus a, another time minus a, but plus a and minus a both give the same loudness. So, in one cycle there are two loud notes, loud, the sound is loud twice. So, therefore, the frequency of the beats is n1 minus n2 by 2 into 2, that is n1 minus n2. So, it is this waxing and waning of sound that we hear as beats, and the number of beats is n1 minus n2. Frequency of beats is the difference of the two frequencies. Again, I show you the same process. Here the waves, two wave trains, one going wave trains, one in blue color, the other in brown color. They are superposed on each other, and what we get is this. And this is the envelope of the wave. You see, this wriggle, fast wriggle, is the actual frequency, the original frequency, and this gives the frequency of the beats. Let us now take a few examples to consolidate the concepts that we have learnt. Example 1, two vibrating tuning forks produce progressive waves given by y1 equal to 4 sin 500 pi t and y2 equal to 2 sin 506 pi t. What is the number of beats? I told you last time that many of these problems I have taken from the competitive examinations held by CBSE and other boards, just to help you to be familiar with the kinds of problems that are asked in the competitive examinations. So, since our wave motion has the form sin 2 pi t, therefore, the frequency of this is 250 and the frequency of this is 253. Notice that the frequency is 2 pi n. Therefore, the two frequencies are 250 hertz and 253 hertz, and the number of beats is therefore 3 per second or 180 per minute. You see, you just have to find the frequency of these two. If you compare with the standard wave equation, the frequency of these two is 250 and 253. Therefore, the number of beats is 3. A tuning fork of frequency 512 hertz makes 4 beats per second with the vibrating string of a piano. You see, piano strings are many times corrected or tuned with tuning forks, which are very pure notes. The beat frequency decreases to 2 beats per second when the tension in the piano string is slightly increased. You also know that if you increase the tension, the frequency increases. What is the frequency of the string? Again, this question is taken from a examination held by the CBSE. You see, since the number of beats is 4, the frequency of the piano string would either be 508 or 516. Now, if it is 516 and then the tension is increased, it will become even higher. So, therefore, the number of beats would increase. Therefore, the number of beats would increase. On the other hand, if it was 548, if it were 548, then the increase in tension would increase its frequency, make it 510, and then the number of beats will be 2. So, the original frequency must be 508, which was increased by tension to 510, so that the number of beats is 2. 516 would have increased, and the number of beats also would have increased rather than decreased. So, that is how you argue. Let us revisit the wave equation. You see, I am going to now take some examples in which you would need this form of the wave equation. We will have to compare the wave equation, given wave equation or given equation, with these forms. And remember that k is 2 pi by lambda and omega is 2 pi nu, and v is omega by k, which is equal to lambda nu. Example 3, a transverse wave is represented by y equal to a sin omega t minus k x. For what value of the wavelength is the wave velocity equal to the maximum particle velocity? Now, particle velocity, you remember, is y dot, and the wave velocity is omega by k. So, wave velocity is omega by k. the particle velocity is dy by dt and the maximum of this is omega a. So, omega a has to be equal to omega by k, and you can use this and you can get from this equation you can get the velocity of the for what wavelength. So, you can come omega a is equal to omega k, and therefore, you can find out lambda, the wavelength for which or the wave velocity for which the particle velocity is maximum. You have just to compare omega a with omega by k. A transverse wave propagating along x axis is represented by this. Again, you see that is why I reminded you of the wave equations. This is a wave equation where x is in meters and t is in seconds. Find the speed of the wave. So, all that you have to do is to find omega by k. So, this is the form a sin k x minus omega t. K is 2 pi by lambda, omega is 2 pi nu. So, you compare with this. So, you will get k equal to 2 pi by lambda, giving lambda is equal to 4 m. Therefore, the speed is lambda nu, which is equal to 8 meter per second square. So, we have just to compare this to find the wavelength k and compare this with this to find omega, and omega pi k is the velocity. We have seen that a string fixed at both the ends or a closed pipe or open at both the ends, all harmonics of the fundamental are present. If the length of the string is L, then the wavelength of the fundamental is lambda equal to 2 L. The frequency of the fundamental mode is given by nu equal to 1 by 2 L square root of T by mu, where T is the tension applied to the string and mu is the mass per unit length of the string. The velocity of propagation of the wave along the string is V equal to nu times lambda or square root of T by mu. As an exercise, you can verify that the square root of T by mu has the dimensions of velocity. Now, the wire of a string instrument is replaced by a wire of the same material, but 1/4 the cross section of the earlier wire. So, we had a wire which we replaced by another wire, and this new wire is of the same material, but its cross section is 1/4 that of the earlier wire. How would the frequency of the instrument be affected? Frequency we saw is to square root of T by mu. Nothing has changed. So, let us see where T is the tension applied to the string and mu is the mass per unit length. If A is the area of cross section of the wire and L is its length and rho is its density, then the mass per unit length would be A L rho by L. L A is the volume multiplied by density gives you the mass divided by the length gives you the mass per unit length. Therefore, mu is A rho. So, for the same tension, nu is square root of, because mu has A in it. So, nu is inversely proportional to 1 by root of A, and A goes or A gets reduced by 4 times. Therefore, the frequency would go twice. A gets A by 4, therefore, frequency becomes 2 nu. So, it becomes twice. The frequency is fixed by the source, that is important thing. You must remember that the frequency is fixed by the source that generates the wave, a tuning fork for example. The frequency is therefore the fundamental property of a wave, and it does not change when wave propagates from one medium to the other. When say wave enters from air to water, the frequency will not change. The wavelength will change, the wave velocity will change, but not the frequency. So, this lambda is V by nu, this relation. So, nu would not change, lambda and V could change. We have learnt one very important thing here in this lecture. I think you should remember that the frequency is fundamental to the wave, that is the property of the wave. When wave enters from one medium to the other, the frequency does not change. What changes is wavelength and wave velocity, and the three are related by this relation. In the next lecture, we shall see sound waves or longitudinal waves and they travel in a certain medium. Here, let me repeat, we have learnt two very important concepts. One is standing waves, how they are formed. I have repeated this process twice to make it clear how the two progressive waves in the opposite direction give rise to the standing waves, and that then the number of beats is equal to the difference of the two frequencies if the frequencies are almost equal. The difference should not be much, at the most 5-6, can't go beyond that. So if the two frequencies are, if the waves of two frequencies are overlapping, then the beats will be heard, that is, the sound will go up and down, and this going up is called wax, this is called waning, and we the number of such waxing and waning would be equal to the difference of the two frequencies, and that the frequency of a wave is a fundamental property of the wave, and it does not change when the wave goes from one medium to the other.